It's a Small World is about the Cold War. It's a Small World is a slow-moving boat ride built in the 60s, which goes past singing dolls from various different countries, singing the frustratingly catchy theme song in their respective languages. It's often derided as this fairly twee and cutesy ride, even by Disney themselves.
Sing something with a little bounce in it.
It's a small world after all.
No! No! Anything but that.
I'm surprised the Lion King remake didn't try and redo this scene with Baby Shark or something equally stupid. Stop remaking things, Disney. I think this ride slaps. More than that, in the words of Freddie Prinze Jr.,
it is brilliant American literature.
Sure, it's problematic, but so is a lot of brilliant American literature. However, I've come off this ride with friends who've been a little unnerved by the whole experience, and these are people who aren't above cutesy Disney stuff. They'll queue 2 hours just to meet a princess. But what if I told you that this slightly unnerving atmosphere the ride creates isn't a bug, but a feature of the ride? What if I told you this underlying existential fear you might experience on this ride and nowhere else in Disneyland is a key part of why this is an enduring classic that uniquely uses its medium to grapple with the fears and anxieties of the time in which it was created? What if I told you that beneath that colourful exterior was a ride that is actually about the impending threat of nuclear war? Because It's a Small World is about the Cold War. Part 1, Disneyland and the Art of Reassurance. Disneyland opened in 1955. During a time of post-war economic prosperity for the United States. However, the looming shadow of communism and nuclear war was seen as threats to this prosperity, leading to a state of American paranoia. This included McCarthyism, a witch hunt of suspected communists, which Walt Disney infamously took part in when he testified in front of the House of Un-American Activities Committee in 1947, providing information on individuals who worked at his studio who he believed to be communists. If you stan Walt Disney, please don't attack me for bringing this up. I swear I love Disneyland just as much as you do, and I'd love to defrost Uncle Walt just as much as you would, except I'd like to do it to show him a video of Superstar Limo and see his reaction.
Agents, execs, producers beyond. Give us a sign, the green light is on.
However, something like McCarthyism didn't directly involve most Americans. Instead, the way your average American experienced the Cold War was this constant underlying anxiety. Every day there was a threat their lives could end because someone presses a big red button and wipes everyone out. It's easy to forget now how real this threat was, as well as how genuinely close the world came to nuclear war, but this was a real fear during this time. So with Disneyland opening during this time, does that mean I'm also going to be saying this means it's about the Cold War? Well, I would definitely say some of the design principles of Disneyland were influenced by the Cold War. When entering Disneyland, all visitors pass under a plaque that I think gives a strong indication of the design intentions that unite the disparate lands and attractions within this park. Here you leave today and enter the world of yesterday, tomorrow, and fantasy. This statement in many ways functions as a thesis statement for Disneyland, and whilst each of the words yesterday, tomorrow, and fantasy represent at least one of the different themed lands within Disneyland, the common thread that links them all is the first part, here you leave today. When Disneyland opened, it was designed as an opportunity to take people out of their present-day lives and away from their everyday troubles, and one big aspect of this in the 1950s was this constant anxiety of the Cold War. My instinct was to describe this as escapism, providing a respite from the worries and pressures of the world, but interestingly, those who designed Disneyland reacted quite strongly against the idea of the park simply being escapism. In 1978, New West magazine published an article titled Disneyland is Good for You, an interview with John Hench, one of the key Disney theme park designers, or as the company describes them, Imagineers. John Hench has been described by fellow Imagineer Tom Morris as the philosopher of Imagineering, though this article hilariously calls him the Magic Kingdom's master manipulator, which feels like such a negative way of framing what he does. Anyway, in the article, Hench directly rejects the idea that Disneyland is escapism, saying, "Entertainment is usually thought of as an escape from problems, an escape from responsibility. What we are selling is not escapism, but reassurance. We stimulate them with another kind of emotion, with a kind of stimulus that says, you're going to be okay." So how was this reassurance created at Disneyland? Well, firstly through constructing a hyper-detailed alternative reality to immerse those within it in a way that temporarily supplants the outside world. By creating environments with order, where visual elements, instead of being in contradiction with each other, work together in harmony. And even the thrilling and scary rides within Disneyland provide you not only that adrenaline which makes you feel alive, but the satisfaction of survival, reassuring you that things will work out. All these elements are designed to work together to envelope guests within an environment that reassures them, so that when they leave, they're enriched with a sense of confidence that things are going to be okay, which they didn't have before they entered, something that pure escapism isn't able to do. During the 1950s, this must have been hugely valuable to a lot of people who had some level of Cold War anxiety. You might be thinking, Mike, just because Disneyland is trying to counteract some level of Cold War anxiety with this reassurance, doesn't make it about the Cold War. And fair enough, good point, I could probably argue against it if I wanted to, but I don't need to, because It's a Small World doesn't fit this reassuring thesis underpinning Disneyland and most of its rides. And that's because It's a Small World wasn't designed for Disneyland. Part 2, The World's Fair and Mary Blair. In the early 1960s, the Cuban Missile Crisis took place. It was when the US and the Soviet Union engaged in a 13-day political and military standoff over the installation of nuclear-armed missiles on Cuba, just 90 miles from the States. This was notably the closest the Cold War ever came to escalating into a full-blown, devastating nuclear war. Also in the early 1960s, Disney began creating exhibits for the 1964 New York World's Fair. If you don't know what a World's Fair is, or as they're known now, World Expos, it's basically a large event with a collection of exhibits representing various cities, countries, and companies. Think Stark Expo from the Marvel films, or if you've ever been to Disney World, Epcot is also heavily influenced by the idea of a World's Fair. The 1964 fair took place in New York, and its theme was Peace Through Understanding. Disney was approached by the fair to build some exhibits, and committed to building three: the Carousel of Progress on behalf of General Electric, Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln for the state of Illinois, and the Magic Skyway for Ford. The style of attractions being designed here differed quite a lot from the rides built up until this point at Disneyland. This was largely due to the different context. Temporary exhibits designed to tie into the wider theme of the fair aim less squarely at purely entertaining, but also trying to inspire, inform, and educate. This meant they could create things that were more timely than timeless. If you've ever had the delightful experience of riding the Carousel of Progress at Disney World, it's very much a relic of the time in which it was created, with the attempt to modernize the final scene showcasing future tech very much a relic of the last time they bothered trying to update it in the 90s.
Well, I'll give it a try.
Take a look around, Grandma. You're in the ship.
Feels like I'm really there.
Okay, get ready. You're about to blast off.
Disney were happily creating these three attractions, but in summer 1963, only 10 months before the fair was due to begin, and less than a year after the Cuban Missile Crisis took place the previous October, Pepsi approached Disney, asking for their help to build an attraction. Pepsi had committed to creating an exhibit on behalf of UNICEF, but due to classic corporate bureaucracy, had failed to start the design process. Out of a sense of desperation, Pepsi approached Disney, and surprisingly, despite the workload his team were under creating the other three attractions, Walt Disney accepted the project, creating the first, but certainly not the last, Pepsi-sponsored plea for peace. On a surface level, It's a Small World was probably the most stereotypically Disney of the rides they brought to the World's Fair. If we use Disney to mean a certain style of family entertainment with cute images and catchy songs. However, by its nature, there are a number of ways it was quite distinct from Disneyland rides. It was built for a different audience, one not immersed within Disneyland, but who were also seeing this alongside competing exhibits. It had to be a standalone experience rather than one part of a unified whole. It served a different purpose. It was not enough for it to simply entertain, but also had to say something about the world. And it had a very different aesthetic from any Disney attraction up until this point. Mary Blair was an artist at the Walt Disney Studio, who first started working there in 1940. Originally an aspiring fine artist, her husband Lee helped her get a job at Disney, where she became one of Walt Disney's personal favourite artists. She was an innovator in her bold use of colour to convey mood, paired with a modernist, flat yet extremely cute style of art. She was also such a favourite of Walt Disney's that she was an innovator in working from home, as when she decided to move to New York, he was so insistent that she stayed working for him that she lived and worked on the opposite side of the country and only flew in for key meetings. Honestly, go boss. Her modernist sensibilities clashed with this illusion of life style of animation that the Disney studio championed. Disney films can never be aware that they're a cartoon, and Blair's style of art didn't mesh with this house aesthetic Disney had become known for. Instead, her role at Disney was primarily as an inspirational sketch artist. She would come onto films early in development and create mood pieces that would inspire the animators working on these films. As such, her art rarely directly appeared in the films she was working on, more influencing and inspiring the look of Disney films throughout the 40s and early 50s. It's only been in the intervening years that much of her art created during this time has been published and made publicly available for appreciation. She left Disney in 1953, but Walt Disney still wanted to work with her, and so approached her a decade later to work on It's a Small World. On this ride, Mary Blair's modernist, colourful style would be front and centre, no longer simply a part of the development process, but her team would be channeling and directly translating her art pieces into the finished product. This visual style was also a fairly radical departure from the style of dark rides that Disney had built up until this point. Rides such as Peter Pan's Flight aimed to immerse their riders within the world of the story being told, where possible attempting to hide the artifice. As part of the overall reassurance thesis of Disneyland, even a scary ride such as Snow White wraps its audience up in a fairytale world, modelled after the illusion of life animation of the films being depicted. However, It's a Small World was being built for the World's Fair, outside of the reassuring confines of Disneyland's realm, and as such, works in a different way. Modernism isn't just an aesthetic choice, but a movement that aims to engage with its audience in a different way. Rather than reassuring, it challenges and confounds by drawing attention to its own artifice. In the same way, It's a Small World knows it's a theme park ride. The flat, minimalist environments evoke a mood of the country rather than depicting a place you could believe exists. The children within the attraction look like dolls rather than expressive characters, and you can even see the ceiling. But because of the style of ride that It's a Small World is, it doesn't hugely detract from the experience, because It's a Small World isn't trying to create an immersive environment, and being part of the World's Fair, that makes sense. You don't go to the World's Fair to be taken away from the world, but instead to engage with it. So what is the ride trying to say about the world then? Part 3. Finally actually analysing the themes of this ride. We've established It's a Small World was built for the 1964 World's Fair, the theme of which was peace through understanding, that it started being designed within a year of the Cuban Missile Crisis taking place, and that it has a modernist art style. Whilst all important context, it's not enough alone to just say, well, it's obviously about the Cold War. Instead, it's important for me to examine how any underlying elements are presented in relation to the Cold War, and what it is saying in relation to this theme. But first I want to clarify what I mean by the term theme here, because often when talking about themes in theme park rides, wires get crossed, and fair enough. They're literally called theme parks, and typically the theme in theme park isn't referring to loss of innocence, it's normally talking about, I don't know, Lego? So I think it's important to define the different uses of the word theme before going forward so this doesn't get too confusing. Michael Younger in his 2016 book, Theme Park Design and the Art of Themed Entertainment, which is basically like the New Testament for theme park theory, creates a distinction between manifestation theme, which is how theme is used in the term theme park. This is literally where the ride is set and what it features, so space or cowboys or space cowboys, versus dramatic theme, which is the literary definition of the word, so the concepts or ideas that a piece of art is about and expressing. For example, a dramatic theme of many of the rides at Disney's Animal Kingdom is man's relationship with nature, whilst the term theming is the physical elements of construction that come together to create both the manifestation and dramatic themes, creating associations through decor, design elements, and so on. So when I'm saying a theme of It's a Small World is the Cold War, and you look at the ride and say, no, the theme is countries, you're absolutely right, that's the manifestation theme. What I'm arguing is that the Cold War is a dramatic theme of the ride. So let's start this analysis like you would if you were reading a poem, by looking at the title, It's a Small World. This is a saying which, according to the Cambridge Dictionary, is said to show your surprise that people or events in different places are connected. You know my old science teacher? Well, it's a small world, isn't it? According to the American Heritage of Idioms, it's existed as a saying since around 1900, so around 60 years before the ride was designed. Here is a play on words, reflecting the ride in two ways. Thematically, small world refers to the changing ways of the world post-World War II. Advances in technology allow for more communication, cultural exchange, and movement between countries than ever before. And then literally the ride depicts a small version of the world, going past scenes showcasing dolls in colourful, stylized versions of different countries, some of which are more problematic than others. While some of these cultural depictions have aged poorly, the intention is to showcase the surface level differences but underline the similarities underneath. With the exception of their clothes and skin tones, all these dolls are essentially identical. In the same way, whilst they're singing in different languages, they're all singing the exact same song. Dolls are a traditional childhood toy, here used to connote the innocence of childhood. Alongside details in the design of the ride, such as glitter and pipe cleaners, it comes together to create a sense of innocence, almost like a child had designed this ride, all enhancing Mary Blair's childlike, cute aesthetic. On a surface level, this is a big part of why the ride appears so happy, to a degree that some people find disarming. But it's worth noting that dolls aren't just toys designed for children, they're toys designed to look like children, and here they're representing the children of the world. And the song these children are singing is far more foreboding than many realise. Now, I get that this song is so infamous and overplayed, but because of this, I think many people haven't looked closely at what the lyrics are saying, because the lyrics to this song contain the thematic cornerstone of the ride. The original concept was every country to sing its own national anthem, which would have been a hot mess. So instead they went to the Sherman Brothers to ask them to write a song that could be easily translated into multiple languages. And boy did they deliver a whopper! The name of this ride was originally Children of the World, but was changed after the song was written. Whilst the song is known as this happy, annoying earworm, like a great Carly Rae Jepsen song, there's a contrast between the surface level joyful presentation and this underlying sadness and anxiety found within the lyrics. So here are the lyrics to It's a Small World.
It's a world of laughter, a world of tears.
Immediately, we have a contrast between two physical reactions to emotion, the positive quality of laughter and the largely negative quality of tears. By bringing the idea of tears, we're already contrasting with the joyful, colourful aesthetic of the ride, and this juxtaposition continues into the next line.
It's a world of hopes and a world of fears.
Again, following the same pattern of positivity followed by negativity, albeit this time with feelings that are a bit more complicated than just being happy and sad. Hopes and fears are often a bit more macro in terms of the problems they're about. If I'm going to be talking about my hopes and fears, I'm probably not going to be talking about stuff that happened to me that day, but more wider conceptual feelings about my life and my future. And here the hopes and feelings are contextualized in terms of the world. It's a world of. So it isn't about an individual's hopes and fears, instead it's looking at hopes and fears through a collective lens. So, a world of fears. What could the fears of the world possibly be during this time? Good thing the next three lines are about to spell it out. There's so much that we share that it's time we're aware. It's a small world after all. So think about where the United States is at this point. There's recently been two massive world wars with enormous loss of life across the globe, sure, but nuclear weapons get invented and suddenly the threat feels different. This is the possibility of millions of civilians being immediately wiped out, including children. This is the first point in history where this has been possible, a global extinction event of everyone on planet Earth with no possibility of escape. The shift in thinking in relation to this is signaled in the line, "It's time we're aware." This is a realization that the way things once were is never coming back, and the world will be forever smaller as our mutual survival is more codependent than ever before. You might be tempted at this point to say I'm reading far too much into this extremely simple song, and fair enough, you're welcome to reject my interpretation. I personally firmly subscribe to Death of the Author, so even if one of the Sherman brothers came forward and explicitly denied this as part of their euphoria intent, I would ignore it, because regardless, I think this is a valid reading. But in case you don't think the same way I do, here's a quote from Richard Sherman about the intentions behind the song.
People think it's a little novelty. It's a prayer for peace. We have to learn to live together and respect each other, or we're gonna blow each other up.
So, have I won you over? Because It's a Small World isn't trying to immerse you in a world detached from reality, riders are very conscious they're on a theme park ride, and so are more likely to be thinking about their own lives and relating the attraction to it. It's easy to forget just how much these nuclear fears would have been playing not just on the minds of those who created the ride, but also those riding during this time, and that's not just adults, that's children as well. Children over the age of 5, as much as we want to protect their innocence, always have some level of awareness of major political events happening in the world. In 1966, so 2 years after It's a Small World opened, the BBC interviewed British children asking them how they pictured life in the year 2000, and I found the answers really illuminating.
Well, in the year 2000, I think I'll probably be the spaceship to the moon dictating robots, or if something's gone wrong with their nuclear bombs, I may be sort of coming back from hunting in a cave.
There's nothing you can do to stop it. The more people who get bombs, the more, somebody's going to use it one day.
And I don't think there's anything to be frightened of, and lots of people think it's going to explode, but I'm certain it won't.
I think this shows how accurately the lyrics of It's a Small World, as well as the ride as a whole, reflected how children of the time felt about their future. That heady mix of imaginative optimism coupled with the fear this could be stripped away at any moment. This is why attempts to update the attraction and make it appeal more to kids by shoehorning in Disney characters has always rung hollow to me as a concept. I could whinge about it ruining the thematic cohesion of the ride, but ultimately it's also something I don't think any kid particularly cares about. Kids are intelligent, they don't need stuff dumbed down for them. They don't need to be able to see stuff they already recognise to engage with something. Not that I would want a modern version of the ride updated to reflect the fears and anxieties of children of today. It would probably end up cringy and start an unnecessary culture war. Plus, sadly, the ride's core prayer for peace will always remain somewhat timely. But next time you get the chance to go to a Disney park, imagine you're in the 60s, think about nuclear weapons, and live the full authentic experience of what it would have been like to ride It's a Small World during the time it was created. Trust me, you'll see it through a whole new light. Anyway, wanna go dance?